I have pushed the record button. This is Ham Radio Now, episode number 403, W7VO for ARRL Northwest Division Director. Hi, I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHG, and today I'm providing you another interview with a candidate running for Division Director, different division this time. I know we've talked to Rhea a couple times. And today, I'd like to introduce you to Mike Ritz, W7VO, and he's running for Division Director in the Northwest section. Hello, Mike. Welcome to Ham Radio Now, and thanks for joining me today.
Thank you very much, Dave. Appreciate being on.
Yeah, that's great. I'm really hoping to get opportunities to talk to all of the candidates that are running. I know that there's five big contests this year. And the My Aerial Voice and a lot of us out there are really hoping to drive some change. And I know you're one of those folks hoping to drive that change.
Yeah, there are all five divisions that are up for election this time. We're contested elections. Probably the first time that's happened in a long time. And yes, we're running on a campaign of change and a campaign of reform.
Yep. And I think that's important. I think that's really needed right now. All the stuff that's happened in the last 6 or 8 months, and if the folks following the show kind of know what's going on, there's some issues with transparency, and there's been some censures and stuff. What drove you to want to throw your hat in the ring?
Well, it started with the fact that I'm the Willamette Valley DX Club president, and about starting in October, one of our board of directors members started coming to our board meetings. And bringing up all the issues, brought up the censure, brought up some of the other stuff that was going on with the board. The disqualification of K3RF comes to mind, and a few other things. And so the club tasked this director to go discuss the issues with our current director, K7CEX, and he really didn't get any response out of him. So finally, after a couple of months of these club meetings where we were going into discussions on what was going on with the board, what was going on with the ARRL, I decided that he wasn't getting anywhere. I had better try to see what I could get. And I did get a response back right away from our current director, basically telling me that there's no issues. There's a few troublemakers out there that are trying to stir the pot and don't really pay any attention to anything. And then I said, he brought up a few things that really piqued my interest. One of them was it became obvious to me that he was, in my opinion, not properly representing our members. Some of the answers that he had on the email exchange that we had, to the point that I decided once I started doing some research on the issues myself, became a lot more familiar with them, talked to some ham friends of mine that that have really been watching the board and ARRL activities a lot more than I have, I came to the conclusion that we as a division and we as the ARRL have to do a better job of communicating with our members and representing the ARRL as a member organization, not just a faceless company that you buy products from. And the more I looked into that, the more I realized that the way to solve what I saw as a problem was to run for the director position. And here now, I started this campaign in March, believe it or not, that early. And now we're here about 2 weeks away from the actual election. So it's been a very fast-paced, very active campaign.
It's kind of a common thread that I've heard from folks. There's been a lot of, hey, we reached out to our director and we didn't really get the answers that we were looking for.
I'm not sure how much of that is the directors and how much of that is related to the threats that were in the code of conduct.
Yeah.
If you read the code of conduct, I'm sure you have, you know that there's our stipulations in there that basically they're not supposed to communicate with the members of anything that's of a negative value or paints the ARRL in a negative way. They basically weren't allowed to do anything or say anything.
Yeah, we've done a number of shows and we went through that in depth and detail. And my biggest concern was looking at the way the clauses are all written and all the requirements. It's much more structured like a corporate organization than a membership organization.
And I think that came down from the top. Mm-hmm. In my opinion, NY2RF was brought in as a corporate guy. Mm-hmm. And I think there was a big push to try to turn the ARRL into a corporation and away from being a member a member organization. I remember thinking of that when he was initially hired. I'm from the corporate world myself. I spent 35 years in the telecommunications industry, retired as a director for a telecommunications company, and so I know how these things work. And when he was initially hired, it became to me that they hired him as a guy who could run a corporation, but not necessarily a member-driven organization. And I think a lot of the things that happened on the board may have been largely due to his input.
Right. It seemed like they were kind of taking it from that membership organization to more of a lobbyist and a bookselling organization.
Yeah. If they do that, then it makes you wonder why they need to have a member organization of board of directors. They should just appoint them, like they do, for example, with AARP and NRA and other people, and just have them as a lobbying organization. You buy books from them, and you don't really have to deal with the members very much.
Right, right.
And that's not what I believe the ARRL is.
And that's not why I joined either. I was hoping to have a voice, and at the table, or at least get feedback back to me. And I think that was the biggest challenge that we heard from talking to different people, was that they were getting kind of blanket answers, and it seemed like it was all cookie cutter. The board decided this, and this is what we're supposed to tell you. And when you wanted to have a conversation around it, there wasn't really an ability to have that conversation back and forth.
That's exactly what happens. And I think part of that is also, I remember when Jim Fenstermaker, K9 JF, was our board of directors member. He would come to our meetings and he would tell us what was going on with the ARRL, right? There wasn't the feedback part of it. It was, what do you guys think about this? We're thinking about doing this. What do you guys think about this? And there was none of that. It was always, here's what the ARRL is thinking of doing, or here's what the ARRL is doing. And that feedback part of it, which is part of communications, right? Communication is not only speaking, it's also listening and taking that input back. And I think that's what's really missing right now on the board of directors.
Yeah, well, I'm voting for my director, and so I'm hoping that my director wants to hear what I want him to represent, maybe a little bit. And, mine is the director that was censured.
Dick Norton.
Yeah, and I actually was his next-door neighbor for about 10 years, literally lived next door to him before I became a ham. And he's a good guy, and he's a nice guy, and it was sad to see what all went down. And I think it's getting better, but I still think that I'm hoping that the five of you all, the five contested races will make some change there.
Well, I heard of, I've talked to Dick Norton a few times. I talked to him down at Visalia when I kind of kicked off my campaign. And, going back to this whole thing of the censure, I think that was absolutely the wrong thing for the board to do. Mm-hmm. If they had issues with his conduct, if they had issues with him, they should have taken him back behind the woodshed internally. But the fact that they ended up publicly censuring Dick basically turned against the board. And a lot of the reasons that people that we're doing what we're doing are as a result of that. And they really ended up turning Dick into a folk hero.
Yes. And I think they're ultimately, it will have done us all a favor if we can be successful by getting folks like you and Rhea and the other folks elected.
And I would say exactly that. The question I have is, was the censuring of Dick Norton a good idea? And the final answer may have been a great idea,
right,
in order to make change on the board.
Right.
I wouldn't be running if there weren't these issues that I see going on there. I'm retired. Mm-hmm. I could be spending time on the radio. You saw on my website, I've got a race car. I could be spending more time with my race car. Mm-hmm. But no, I think it's time to work and getting the league back to working for its members.
Yeah, absolutely. And we appreciate you running and helping to do that. I've got your website up here, and there's a great election page here. Is there stuff that you want to talk about? I know that you have some bulleted items here about what your hopes are. Can we talk about those? What are you hoping to do?
What I'm hoping to do is, as you know, the ARRL came out with a strategic plan in 2016 that was basically written by a committee on the board of directors that consisted of a then vice president. Several board members and also some section managers wrote this five-year strategic plan. Mm-hmm. And I find it very interesting that we have yet to hear anything from the board as to where they are on this five-year strategic plan. The five-year strategic plan had 6 points, which you have on my website there. I've also got it actually printed out right next to me that includes such items as grow amateur radio worldwide, right? How are we going to get the not only here but the rest of the world involved? Increasing the vitality of amateur radio was one of their goals. Keeping amateur radio accessible to all. And there I think I talk a little bit about the Parity Act and about some other things that they can do to keep, for example, mitigating noise issues, advancing amateur radio science and technology, organizing and training volunteers to serve their communities, right? That's part of the ARES program. I think they do a good job of that. Yep. And we can probably talk a little bit more about that later. That's I know that's your bailiwick.
Yeah.
And also the last one is practice good governance and organizational management. And my big thing there is I think they really need to focus on that. You know, with lack of transparency comes a lack of trust. And I believe a lot of members have lost trust in the ARRL. I think there are two big factors that they've got going for them right now or against them is people are not seeing the ARRL as value. If you look at, and the second one is value, and the second one is transparency. And with lack of transparency comes distrust. And I believe there's a lot of members that both distrust what's going on with the ARRL and don't find value in being a member. You know, $49 is a lot of money to spend. And people aren't seeing, I believe right now, they're getting that value for that $49 a year.
Yeah, I know there's a lot of folks that I've talked to in our ARES organization that are members or not members, depending. And some of them just look at it as a really expensive magazine subscription.
You know? Yeah, it is. And it's surprising, though, that the magazine, though, is completely paid for by advertising.
Right.
They could not publish the magazine, and it wouldn't cost them a dime.
Yeah, and that you know, and I always try to like straighten people out on that. I was like, that's not what it's there for. That's not what it's all about. It's about representation, and then folks ask about, well, how am I being represented? And they don't get it. And sometimes I don't get it either.
Well, there's representation regarding the issues, and there's also mm-hmm. the huge amount of advocacy for our hobby with the Congress and with the FCC. You know, mm-hmm. we owe our spectrum and our very lives as amateur radio operators to the ARRL. I wrote an article that was published last year called The History of the Ham Radio Call Sign. And if you get a chance to take a look at that sometime, I've got a link to it on my website. I talk about as a result of World War I, we almost lost the ability to be radio amateurs at all. The Navy wanted to keep the radio spectrum to themselves, have it controlled by the military, and the ARRL stepped in and basically got us our spectrum back and got amateurs back on the air. So without them, we probably wouldn't even have amateur radio right now, and people really need to understand that.
Yeah, there's the article. I will definitely take a look at that.
Well, that's not the article. Oh, that's the history of my own call sign.
Oh, okay.
Let's see. It's actually a PDF that's off the election page, I believe. But anyway, yeah, I've traced my own call sign back to the early 1920s, and that's what really got me going to want to write the article, uh-huh. Was tracing my call sign back to its very beginnings as it was 7VO before it was even W7VO. And all the people that have done it, the last two people that have owned my call signs, I've done extensive research and actually have some of their old call signs, and it's really been quite an adventure.
Interesting.
And then I also have quotes from people who knew them uh-huh. or were relatives of theirs as they went through.
And one copy of somebody's QSL card as well.
Yeah, and actually there's a W7VO call sign from Andy Anderson, who owned the call in early on, and then 6UO had the call sign before mm-hmm. Before he became W7VO.
That's
and
cool.
And there I am at the bottom. History still to be made.
Yes, and you are still making history, and some stuff in the past too, right? You've done a lot of stuff, the DX Club, and your participation. It looked like you did some ARES stuff as well.
I'm actually pretty active. You know, amateur radio is a very large umbrella. There's a lot of things you can do.
Yep.
I originally got started before I was even a ham, growing up in Long Beach, California. I don't know if you're familiar with Long Beach. There's a big hill in the middle called Signal Hill,
mm-hmm.
and the local radio club there used to sponsor a transmitter hunt. Once a month on a Monday, we'd all get in our cars, and this was before I was even licensed. I had some friends that had got their ham tickets back when I was in high school, and they used to meet on top of Signal Hill, and they used to have a transmitter hunt that would start there, and the other transmitter could be anywhere within the city bounds of Long Beach, which is quite a few square miles. So we'd drive around with little loop antennas, basically within where they were tube radios, strapped to the seat of our car mm-hmm. With an inverter, you know, running back with some cables to the battery. And we'd run around, try to find these hidden transmitters. And that's what really got me started at the very beginning of amateur radio. I was involved in electronics since an early age, about 9 years old, when I would take my my grandfather gave me a 1937 Zenith transoceanic radio when I was nine in the late 50s, or I said early 60s. And I took the radio. First thing I did, of course, as a young kid, was take the radio apart. And I found out that if I put a wire on a certain little pin of the of a tube, I could knock out their TV set in the living room. So every time I got sent to my room being in trouble, the first thing I'd do is crank that radio on and wipe out their TV set.
Did they figure it out?
No, they never figured it out. And, you know, I actually felt guilty when they died that they never knew it was me that knocked their Dodgers game out in the middle of the afternoon. And they actually brought the service guy out a couple of times, and I'd be in my room snickering. You know, but I got started into that's the radio side of it at an early age. And I'd say I actually felt guilty at the end that it was me that did that. But, you know, that's what little 9 year old kids do. I'm also surprised I didn't get electrocuted.
Yeah. They don't do a lot of the transmitter hunt stuff in this area anymore. I don't know if they're doing it up there.
No, it's not really, because I think you'd have a lot more problem with police looking around wondering what the heck you're doing.
Yeah.
I mean, we would have people dressed up in women's clothes, dressed up as a bag lady, walking through the streets of downtown Long Beach, you know, with a transmitter hidden in a shopping cart, you know, or they'd be in they'd be at the end of a jetty at the Long Beach Pier, and they'd run their coax underneath the water and then have the antenna on the other jetty on the other side. So you'd clamber across the rocks to get all the way to the other side, only to find out that
just the
transmitter was actually, you know, a mile away under on the other jetty. But it was just kind of stuff like that. It was all that stuff that was very fun. I'm also involved in Aries as a deputy EC for our local county here. I was involved at the state level to help them develop their ARO training program. So I've been pretty active, not only in many aspects of the hobby. My primary one is I'm a HF DXer and contester, and I do a lot of mentoring of new hams and new HF people as part of what I do here in the county.
Mm-hmm. So in we talked a little bit about the Aries and the Aries changes. How much are you following along with what's going on with the organization? There's the new Aries Connect and some of the new requirements that have come out.
Yeah, we have just got hooked up with Aries Connect. I don't know much about it. Mm-hmm. I understand. I believe why they're doing it. And that is, if you ever look at the QST magazine, you'll see that they have the SEC reports. And you'll find out that out of the however many sections there are, there are very few that actually report anything every month. And, of course, the ARRL is very involved with FEMA, and they're probably, I'm sure, looking for grant dollars. Yep. And the more Aries activity they can show, the more chance they have of getting grant dollars.
Right, it's just
like
show value.
Else.
Yeah, and I think part of it's that. I think part of it as well is if you look at what happened with Puerto Rico, you know, they put out a call, and having a database of members that have already told you ahead of time, hey, I can do these things and I'm available. Will make it easier to go out and find, you know, they were looking for 50, they got 22.
Oh, really?
And, you know, those people went and they provided great service, but having that database would have helped them find more skilled operators, more qualified operators, and maybe the numbers that they were initially looking for.
That's correct, but that's only half of it. The other half is they're trying to come up with national standards for Aries activity. I actually support that to a point.
Uh-huh.
I have been getting emails from some local people here that are pretty upset with it, showing that they're saying that if they do put these standards into place, especially stringent standards, that they're likely to lose a lot of members. But I mean, if you look at the future of the future of Aries is digital, using PacTor and WinLink and gateways. And I think a guy showing up now with his handy talkie strapped onto the side of his belt, it will be, you know, less useful going forward as we move into the digital age. And I think the only way to be able to be part of that is to get training.
Yeah,
and I think so. There has to be minimum standards. Oregon has very stringent standards for being a full Aries member. You have to go through a background check before our local county will even let you into the EOC at all. You have to go through and take the ICS courses. And then we also have an online training course that essentially teaches you the basics of NBIS and how some of the HF side of it works. And also WinLink training. And then the last part of that is you have to actually show that you know how to use your radio and show that you know how to program a frequency in and that, you know, it's just not an appliance for you.
The training course you talked about, that's your group. Is that something you guys put together?
Yeah, the state of Oregon.
Uh-huh,
it's the state. It's OregonERS.org. Has done that. Of course, right now that's kind of on hold, waiting to see what they come up with at the national level. I know there's also more consideration coming as far as the leadership having to take required FEMA courses.
Yep.
I've heard a lot of pushback on that because of the fact that those courses are only offered at locations. You can't take them online. You have to go there. Particularly in Alaska, they said if that pushes through, they may have to completely pull out of the ARES program because they don't have access to those FEMA courses.
That's actually been the one concern I have about it. I'm an EC, and I've been an EC for 5 or 6 years and very active. But even in Los Angeles, I can't get the 300 or 400 course, and you have to go. You have to go sit in a classroom. And we looked online this year. The only place they offered FEMA offered it this year was in Alabama.
Wow!
And apparently they're training the trainers, folks from the ARL, and hopefully by the end of the year they should have folks out in the field that should be able to provide those courses that would be certified and allow you to get those certifications. But my EC role is potentially, up in the air until they figure out what they're going to do. And I believe that there's a stipulation in there that the section manager can make special dispensation for a certain amount of time to allow us to continue to participate and do the things we do. But the same as you, I think good and bad. It would be great to be able to say every operator that's a member of ARES has a background check, does the 100, 200, 700, 800 courses, so that at least they have an understanding of how all the professionals are supposed to operate and expect us to operate.
Correct.
And I think it would be good to have some more targeted, I did the ARL EC-001 course a number of years ago, and I think courses like that are much more aimed at operators about what we're supposed to do as amateur radio operators, both with the amateur radio world, but also to kind of cover the topics that our served agencies are going to want us to be able to help them with. You know, they may want us to man their phones, man their radios, man their equipment, and to just give us an idea of what are the different things that we may be asked to do. And of course, you're not going to be able to provide training at a detailed level because every group's, every professional's equipment is different, but at least to get us the mindset that we may be called to do whatever, including sneaker net stuff.
Right.
As communicators, and that's what we should be expecting to do. Not that, hey, I do this, and this is all I do.
Well, it's not only that, but one thing you have to really keep in mind, Dave, is that we work at the pleasure of our served agencies, and those vary widely as far as how much they'll allow us to do. I'm very lucky here in Columbia County, Oregon, that we work very closely with our emergency manager, and he really relies on us. We're a fairly rural county, 625 square miles, a lot of hills, and only about 40,000 people. So it's a very rural county. And we're isolated from Portland. We're about 25 miles northwest of Portland with one major road in and one major road out. And if there's ever a large scale disaster here, such as they were talking about the Cascadia earthquake, we would be isolated for who knows how long. If FEMA did come in a large earthquake, all their resources would be going to Portland, where the 2 million people live. And they're really not going to be caring too much about Columbia County. So our ability to work with our local emergency manager is very critical.
Did you participate in the events, I guess, last year or the year before they had the Cascadia Rising?
I sure did. I was helping to man our local EC in Columbia County. And there were some issues that came up, a lot of communication issues with our OEM office down in Salem. There was a big debrief about it. And really, I don't know how much has changed, but not a whole lot has changed since then. There's been a pretty good turnover in the management of our state OEM amateurs down there, and hopefully we have a new section manager who's also our section emergency coordinator, and hopefully he'll be able to correct some of that.
Well, that's why we drill. That's why I always tell people when we have problems when we drill, that's the right thing. Then we figure out where there's challenges and where we need to improve or fix things or learn the lessons.
Right, and we usually have three or four drills a month. Mm-hmm. We've got one coming up here in August that we actually had, instead of the leadership crafting the drill, we actually had the membership themselves sit down and come up with their own drill, understanding that the things that they have to do. And you have to, you know, keep these things going. I don't use WinLink that often. And every now and then, you know, we decide to have a drill. And it's like, oh, shoot, what do I have to do to get this? Oh, that's right. I got to click here, and then I got to click here. Unless you do it all the time, you really lose that that edge and skill. And during a disaster, you definitely want to have that skill ready and available. And the way to do that is through not only training but exercises.
I think that's a great idea. You had the operators come up with the drill. What did they come up with?
They kind of came up with a major wind event in Columbia County. We're right on the Columbia River here, and the storms that come in come right up the Columbia River. So they come up with a storm event where we have lost communications. We have internal communications. Our repeaters are still up. And we're actually going to be talking about that tonight. I believe the exercise will be next month. It'll be interesting to see how it goes. You know, the leadership will act as mentors, but they're basically going to run the show. And the purpose of that is not only to provide training, but to find out what they feel they're deficient in.
And how did it work out?
We haven't done it.
You haven't done yet. Oh, got it.
It'll be in I believe in October.
Sorry, I had to mute because the garage door opened. I might want to follow up with you in email and see how did that work for you, because I think that's a great idea. You know, engaging the membership, that's definitely a way to get them involved and get them participating.
And getting back to the ARRL, that's exactly what you have to do. You know, it's not only us standing up there talking to them and providing the PowerPoints of how you do this and how you do that. The idea is you got to get them involved too, and the ARRL, I believe, is, you know, the same way.
How much territory is Northwestern Division? What does that cover for you?
The Northwestern Division, believe it or not, as I actually calculated, it's 1 million square miles, but it covers Oregon, Washington, Idaho, Montana, and Alaska. Mm-hmm. And a total membership was about 12,000. Now we're down to 11,000 and some change. You know, ARRL membership has been dropping the last few years. That's another big concern of mine. You know, you can't have a member organization that's losing members.
Sure.
Pretty soon you don't have an organization anymore.
Do you have any ideas about how many licensed operators? So ARRL members aside, but how many licensed operators are in that space?
I believe there's about 750,000. And that's something else I want to talk about. But the ARRL has to decide what it is, and it has to decide it has to find a way to reach the amateur, the quote-unquote amateurs that they're reaching right now. I'm also a volunteer examiner, and mm-hmm. I've proctored not a whole lot of sessions. I'm more active in Aries and the contesting and mentoring side of it. But on the VE side of it, you know, most of the people that are getting amateur radio licenses their plan is not to be a radio amateur and have it as a hobby. Their idea is to have it as a backup for their church, mm-hmm. For their maybe part of a disaster response team in their hospital. Mm-hmm. They're a four-wheel drive club member that find out that, you know, that 2 meters works a lot better than CB. And so there's people are getting ham licenses without the intention really of it as a hobby. You know, back in the days when I was young and you were young too, most radio amateurs, it became a hobby for them, not just an appliance. And, you know, with the cheaper, the Chinese radios that are coming in, I think have been a big part of that. You know, the cost of entry of amateur radio is certainly a lot less than it was when I was a kid. Mm-hmm. And I think that's a big part of it. And the league has to figure out a way to capture that part of the target amateurs.
Mm-hmm. How to better serve them and get them involved.
Get them involved.
So when I asked about membership, I know it's like about 750,000 nationwide, but in your section, do you have an idea?
It's about 11,000. Membership 11,000. That I don't know.
Yeah, okay.
That's
interesting.
A good question.
It'd be interesting to know like how many amateurs live in your area that aren't part of the ARRL. That's something we talk about in Los Angeles County as well.
Yeah, I know that we have about 11,500 or so ARRL members. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I imagine we probably are pretty close on standard with the national standards, mm-hmm. which indicates that, you know, it's basically, I believe, about, I think I calculated it, that it's about five. We have about 5% of the amateurs in the United States. Are actually involved.
Okay. So there's definitely room to improve there, just like everywhere else.
There's much improvement. Like I say, it's probably a pretty close to a nationwide trend. If you look at the ARRL annual report, you'll see that the number of amateurs are going up, the number of league members are going down. Mm-hmm. And they actually predicted that. And why an organization, a member organization, would want to have a negative number as a goal, I can't quite figure out. But that's what they've got.
So you know, in a perfect world, not a perfect world, in the dream world of the future, if and when you get elected, what do you see? What do you see life changing for you? You know, you're going to be covering four states or five states worth of.
It's five states.
Five states. How do you think things are going to change? What's your plan in terms of getting out there and talking to folks? And
with that many states, I can't do it by myself. Yeah. A million square miles, right?
It's a lot.
And our current directorship, I think, has tried to do it and really hasn't. I don't think really been communicative. With it, you know, it's more than just going to the conventions and standing there and shaking hands and kissing babies. It's about getting out there. During my campaign, I visited. I think I'm going to the Spokane convention this weekend. It'll be I think my 20th event and club that I've gone to in the last 3 months. And I was just last week in Seattle twice and in Idaho once, going to these club meetings and not only telling people what I'm doing, but get their feedback to find out what needs to be done.
Yeah.
And so if I became director, that's exactly the same thing I would do. I'm a high energy person. I'm retired. I've got lots of time. And I really look forward to it. One thing I will say is that I mentioned I can't do it myself. And one thing I would have to do, I think, is get some assistant directors in mm-hmm. each of the division or each of the sections that can help me out and help them communicate with their with the people there and bring that input back. I obviously can't talk to a million square miles worth of people all the time.
Yeah, absolutely. It surprises me, you know. I bring this content out to the world as much as I can, and I hit 5,000-6,000 people on a pretty regular basis. And I often wonder, you know, we're communicators. How can we use this kind of technology, this Skype technology, or these kind of chat rooms with video, to help folks like you that now all of a sudden go from, you know, I'm just working with my local areas group to now I've got five states to cover and all these miles, to bring groups together to be able to share this information and then get feedback as well. I think that's really key and important, something to look at.
I think it's very important. And like I said, it's something I can't do by myself, and I definitely plan on putting a team together to assist me. And it will be a full-time job. You know, I'm looking mm-hmm. at this thing. I did have a long talk with my wife, believe it or not,
she's on board.
Decided to do this.
Yeah, she's on board.
And I'm also president of Lima Valley DX Club. I'm mm-hmm. an active contester, and I will have to scale some of that back. But yeah. I believe this mission is important. I believe the future of the league is important. I've been a life member since basically as long as I've been a ham. Mm-hmm. I was a life member back in my very early 20s, knowing this was going to be a lifelong passion. And if I didn't feel it was important, I wouldn't be doing it, believe me.
What came first, the race cars or the radios?
Actually, the radios. The radios came a lot earlier. And as I had kids, my kids weren't really interested in it. They were more mechanically inclined.
Uh-huh.
And I ended up... actually, another friend of mine also, it was Ham, very well-known Ham, got involved in it, and I ended up building a race car and raced it for 20 years. I was off the air for a while when I lived in Silicon Valley because of work obligations and travel, and the fact that I was getting into my neighbor's stereo in the middle of the night while he was sleeping and turning his touch sensor lights on and off, and and you know, all the stuff that you have living in an urban setting.
Mm-hmm.
I went off the air for a few years. I'm still active with the clubs, but not really on the air. And mm-hmm. Since I moved up to Oregon here, I picked a good place to retire with no restrictions as far as antennas are concerned, no HOAs. The county really didn't care about my tower. You know, I'm living the ham dream life right now.
You're in much more in a rural environment where you are.
Very rural. It's so rural, as a matter of fact. When I first moved up here, I went down to the local planning commission to see what I needed to do to put a tower up. And the lady behind the counter, you know, had her little glasses and looked at me and said, "What? You know, I'm going to put an amateur radio tower up." And the only questions they had is, "Well, if it falls down, what can it fall on?"
Yeah, what's going to hit?
"Well, I've got 2 acres. It'll fall on my property." Well, can it hit any power lines? "No, it's going to be engineered such that it can't hit power lines." "Okay, thanks. Have a nice day. Bye. Go put it up.
Go build it, right?"
Yep, go build it and have fun.
That's
the last
great.
Two words she said was "have fun," and having the ability to live in a county like that, you know, was really refreshing from coming up from you know, from Silicon Valley.
Uh huh. That's great. So you're in a city, but it's small town.
It's a very small town. I actually don't even live in a city. I live in a rural county. The county, I live in a burg, which is an unincorporated part of a county. And the county, I say, is 625 square miles, but only 40,000 residents. And the little burg that I live in is only 700 people. And I live on 2 acres. I've got lots of room for antennas, which I've taken advantage of.
Mm-hmm. How do you do internet out there?
Believe it or not, that's kind of an interesting question. When I first moved up here, I told my boss I was going to retire. You know, my house in Mountain View, California, was about a mile from Google's headquarters. And when Google went public in 2005, our house prices, you know, skyrocketed.
Sure.
And I decided, when my wife decided to retire from Stanford Life Flight, that I was going to retire up to Oregon in 2007. So I ended up, the house became very valuable. It was time to move on.
And so internet-wise, you're wired?
Oh, go back to the internet. So anyway, so I first moved up to this rural county, and the first thing I did was I got HughesNet, satellite internet. I needed to have internet to be able to talk with work. I actually telecommuted for my last 8 years of employment. I tried to quit. They wouldn't let me quit. So I said, well, I'll tell you what, why don't you telecommute? I was the director of product marketing, and so I did a lot of flying out to visit customers and follow the sales guys around. And as part of that, I was just as easily able to fly out of PDX as I was out of San Jose. So it actually worked out very well. But I needed to have a high-speed internet connection. Mm-hmm. And so I got a satellite connection, which worked okay. And then one of my neighbors came over one day and said, hey, why don't you just use Comcast?
Comcast?
Cable. See that line that runs along that telephone pole?
Uh-huh.
That's a cable line.
Uh-huh.
What? They've got cable out here? And sure enough, they do.
So you get really good high speed.
Yeah, I've got 60 megabits of internet, and yet I live, in a very rural area. But if you get a few miles away from here, that goes away.
Yeah, the cables only run to certain areas. So you
right,
got lucky.
And I'm very, very happy with it too.
You got lucky with that. Yeah, because the bandwidth that's coming back, your picture's really good and the signal's great. And some of the times that I talk to folks that are in rural areas, it's a little choppier. And so I'm interested in how you're connected.
Yeah, it's I was very lucky in the fact that I'm close to the edge. The bad news is for DSL, I'm the last, very last house on the line and the farthest from the CO, which would be horrible. But as far as the cable, it was a real easy shot, and poof, here I am.
Yeah, and cable doesn't matter, and I've been in both. I had DSL, and we switched to cable, and I'd never go back. Even if you're closer with the DSL, it's not the best experience.
Yeah, so I had really the best of both worlds. I've been able to live in a rural area yet still have the connectivity.
That's great. Someday we'll join you out. We'll join you out there. My wife and I have been talking about getting out of the big city, and that's one of the considerations we have, because she travels for a living as well, but when she's not on the road, she's at home and needs that good internet connection. And so that's one of those, in addition to, I want to have a space to put up a tower, we need to have good internet so that, we can continue working, remotely when we need to. And it is a challenge.
Columbia County, Oregon, Scappoose, Oregon is where you want to move to.
Okay. Well, we'll add that to the list of things. I got a great picture of your car here. You did you build this all yourself?
I built this myself. This is a 1966 Plymouth Barracuda Formula S. Originally, it was a street car, and kind of almost by accident, I ran into a guy who actually raced these things back in the 1960s.
Uh-huh.
His name was Scott Harvey. He was the engineer who actually worked for Chrysler and developed the Formula S package for the Barracuda. He was a very well-known rally driver, and I met him at a car show in Southern California. And he started feeding me information about how they raced them. And then I realized that there weren't any of the cars left. And so I ended up using some documentation I got from him and from the FIA in France and built a car that met the specifications and then was able to go historic racing in the car for close to 20 years before I retired. Once I retired, it takes a lot of money to keep a race car going, a lot more than amateur radio. And I had to make the decision to park the car. It now sits in my garage and gets taken to car shows, but the car racing part of it is pretty much done.
Yeah. Well, it's probably kind of hard on your body, too.
It is. It's more hard on the body, but it's also, what happens if the car gets wrecked?
Oh, got it.
Right? It's a fairly rare car. They didn't build that many of them.
Mm-hmm.
And body parts are very hard to find. It's historic racing. There's not supposed to be... you know, incidents, but there always are, right? Yeah. The red mist. And I was very fortunate to have driven the car over 5,000 miles on the track over 18 years of racing, and it only ever got touched one time, which was up here at Portland during one of my races. But it's a very expensive hobby. Amateur radio, maybe my wife here is happier. It's a lot. Amateur radio is really a lot less expensive than a race car.
Right. And it's easy to sell because there's some benefit to the community. You can work that angle.
That's correct. Yes.
Work that angle. So what else? What else about? What else can we help the folks out there that are in your section? Know, or not your section, your division, know about you to help them?
Well, I want to make a couple of comments. One of them is that our division director put out an email to all the clubs here fairly recently, and a couple of people sent it to me. And in there, I was characterized as he mentions that leadership is not having a bunch of or spending a bunch of money and owning a bunch of radios. And he didn't really point that at me, but it was obvious that it was directed, you know, my direction. I've had a very successful campaign. I was able to raise a lot of money early to fund my campaign. I've sent out a lot of mailers that I've been able to do. And I mentioned that I've put many, many miles on my car going to various clubs. And yes, I do have a larger amateur radio station than most. I have a contest station. I'm sure you've got a picture of it there. But my big part of contesting now is bringing in new hams and bringing in new local people here in our community, and getting them involved in amateur, getting them involved and on the air. There's a picture there of my station.
That's the entry into your.
That's right. I've actually built my station in my shop.
Uh-huh.
And there's a picture of a couple actually my wife is there on the near foreground, and that's Daryl K7GYM, who came in as a relatively not on the air at all, and now he's one of the most active contesters I have in the club. Mm-hmm. That's one of the stations that we operate the contest from. And if you scroll down one more, there's a second station right here that's our backup station, or we can operate as a multi-two in the bigger contests. And then the third one down there is my boat anchor station,
which is all
the stuff that I use when I want to get nostalgic.
Well, you know, I think it's so interesting because, you know, the way you kind of described it is that it's maybe not a good thing that you've got a lot of equipment, but if you've got a lot of equipment and you're sharing it and you're bringing people in and you're teaching about the hobby, I think that's the folks that I want to support, right?
Well, the two things that I am is, number one, I'm on the air, right? Yeah. I'm on the air and active. And the second thing is, I don't use the station necessarily for my own gain. I've been in amateur radio a long time. I've done a lot of contests. I've set several records, one of which still exists. But you know, it's time now to move it on to the next generation. I have brought, I think, about 5 members now of the Willamette Valley DX Club have gone through my station and done contesting at my station in order to get active, and actually ended up joining the Willamette Valley DX Club, which is our, you know, the membership for that used to be having DXCC, but it's for people that want to get involved in working DX. And that's, you know, working DX is just one part of amateur radio, but it's a one part that a lot of people don't get much of a chance to do.
Right. And I think that's really key is having folks like you that are willing to bring people in and be patient, you know, because not everybody can mentor.
Right. It's not all about having a big station. It's what you do with it.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. You could sit there by yourself, you know, with your locked doors and, you know, work contests all the time. But, you know, you choose to open the doors and bring people in, and I think that that's really important.
Well, one thing I'm planning on doing, the CQ Worldwide Ritty Contest is coming up in, I believe it's a weekend after next, and I'm actually planning on bringing in an 8-year-old newly licensed ham and his dad, who contacted me through the Willamette Valley DX Club. He's a young kid who just got his technician class license, tried to operate the novice Roundup Ritty a couple of weeks ago on 10 meters, which is the only band he can really get on, and ended up with no contact. So I invited them to come down to my station during that contest, and we're going to stick both of them on the air.
Great.
And we'll have an 8-year-old kid operating the CQ Ritty contest. It'll be a lot of fun.
Yeah.
And that's really what amateur radio is, you know, is meant to be. If we don't mentor the new kids and the new people coming through, our hobby is going to disappear.
Well, and hopefully you'll, you know, light a spark in that kid to keep him involved in the hobby for a long, long time.
Well, luckily, his dad is an extra class. They have a little small station with an old TS-130 and a, you know, dipole. Mm-hmm. And I think once he comes out here and, you know, with a couple of towers and big antennas and some power, I think, you know, and he's actually working people all over the world. You know, one of the parts about contesting that really I think is really a blessing is the fact that you think of these 48-hour contests. We're working people all over the world around the globe during those 48 hours. You know, you're actually able to travel your signal around the world twice during that 48-hour period and visit with people on all sides of the globe. And that's an opportunity that not very many people have, but people can get involved through mentoring with their local amateurs, other amateurs.
Yeah, I think that's really key and it's really important. So anything else you want to share with the listeners out there to help kind of drive decisions?
Got a grassroots organization. If anybody is watching this, it's in the Northwestern Division. If you like what you hear here, please pass the word around. I mean, Rhea and I are both kind of running grassroots, very similar campaigns. There are a total of 5 divisions. Three of them have, you know, kind of got a late start and are trying to, make a difference. But they've, you know, they don't quite have the head start that Rhea and I have. And let's try to see what we can do to, as they would say, you know, make the ARRL great again.
Yeah, absolutely. And
that's the new MAGA.
Yep. I'm hoping that will definitely happen. Well, thank you so much for visiting with me today. We'll get this
anytime.
Show posted up, and I'll send you links, and you can share it with everyone, and hopefully we can see a big win soon.
All right. Well, thank you very much. I certainly appreciate it, and have a great day.
Yep. Thank you so much. I'm going to do my closing here. If you like what we're doing, please visit HamRadioNow.tv. Look for Arvin, click the pig, and help support us. You can watch this for free, but I can't do this for free. It takes a little bit of money, not a lot, hosting and equipment and whatever. So please support us and support all these folks that are running for ARL director. Again today, my guest, W7VO Mike Ritz. He's running for ARRL Northwestern Division director, and I wish you the best of luck.
All right, thank you.
All right,
we'll keep working.
Absolutely. Have you ever watched our show?
No.
Okay. So we have a a regular close, and it's not great radio practice, but we do it anyways because somebody complained once, and so it's kind of stuck with us. I'm going to do the first two words. You'll do the last one. Hopefully, you'll understand what it is when we get there. This was Ham Radio Now, episode number 403, W7VO. For ARRL Northwestern Division Director, I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHG. I want to thank my guest. Over and
out.
Perfect. You got it.
That All right. Easy. Thank you, Dave.
Thank you so much. You have a great day, and I'll send you links for this soon.
All right. Sounds good. Thank you.
Thank you.
Right. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.